when the opportunity presented itself to do a book, I felt a little bit embarrassed about it. The only way I was going to do it was if I could make it, if I could be candid, open, honest, and I felt it was important to do that in order to help other people that were struggling.
Well, you certainly have been honest, and you said at times it was painful to go back and look at your childhood, and your mum and dad split up when you were one, and your mum was dealing with her own mental health issues, only something you recognise now as an adult. Of course, when you're a child, you don't understand all of that. You were put into foster care, and you had these feelings that there was just nobody there that cared for you.
I felt like I didn't belong, and you know what, looking back, as a man now, I don't blame my mum. You know, when I talk about my mum in this book in the early days and when she was going through a divorce and two young kids, it must be hard for her to read, but she's a success story in her own right, because she's overcome her mental health struggles, and I get it now. You know, she was really going through a tough time and she couldn't cope, so... it's as much about me, as her, as it is about me, this book as well.
And you did turn self-destructive, didn't you?
Yeah, I did. Yeah, I just couldn't deal with the pressure, and it was mainly the pressure I was putting on myself. As I've said many times before, I felt like I needed to be the best X Factor winner that there'd ever been, and people were saying I was credible.
After that success, after the fantastic success that night. Where did your head go?
I was like, this doesn't feel like what I thought it would feel like. And I think I just got very lost in the... there's a lot of judgment going on, and I would focus on the negativity, and that's really what it was.
Because it's like that child again, listening to all the negative stuff.
A little lost boy, that's how I describe it in the book. I was still a lost little boy, and I didn't know how to cope with it.
And I think coping is like the key phrase here, because you did cope with it, mm-hmm. and you've made huge changes in your life. There's a brilliant section in the book that talks about anxiety and how you cope with that, and that goes back to what Phil was saying the last time you were here and you didn't want to have that anxiety attack. Mm-hmm. Something a lot of people have. I mean, we've talked about it on here, and lots of people have terrible, crippling anxiety. Yeah. Your coping mechanisms, what do you do to control it?
Well, I mean, first of all, I think breathing is paramount. You know, you need to breathe, really, and that tends to be the catalyst for anxiety attacks, is we're not breathing properly, we're shallow breathing. And just trying to remember where you are, and, you know, quite often I think anxiety is brought on by trying to control things in the future, trying to look, you know, anticipate things, because that will only ever bring on anxiety, or looking back at your past and trying to change things that have already happened. You can't do it, so you just kind of be riddled with anxiety if you're trying to do either of those things. So stay in the moment, own up to what's going on, own up to your mistakes, and speak about them. Say, look, I'm having anxiety because I've messed up here, and I've made these mistakes, and I want to change them. And you have to really want to change. You have to want to change your lifestyle, I think. You've got to like yourself. You've got to love yourself. I was beating myself up. I didn't have much self-worth. So, that was probably the main issue, and I think that's a good start.
Do you like yourself now?
Yeah, I do. I don't mind myself. I think I have the right level of insecurity to keep my feet on the ground. I don't have a massive ego. I like to stay humble. I like to relate to the average person with my music and who I am, and I like to be accessible. I don't want to be a big megastar or anything like that.
Well, I mean, and the thing is, it's amazing how when you're open and honest, how forgiving people are and how welcoming they've been back to you and your career once again. I mean, it's like a second chance, really, and not many people get that, I don't think.
When you were talking to our team, that there was one aspect that you were quite interested in that you haven't done anything about yet, but you would like to, and that's acting.
Yeah, I would like to get involved in that. I mean, my life the last 5 years has been about being James Arthur, this artist, and talking about myself all the time, and I like the idea of pretending to be someone else. Getting on a set and being creative in a different way. I love being creative, and acting something I think is quite similar to performing on stage and trying to sell your music to people. You know?
Mm. And you did that at school, didn't you?
I did a bit of that. I did a few productions and won a few awards, and I loved that buzz of playing different characters. If you look at my Instagram, I'm always doing stupid. It's the one place where you get to see me not being so serious, because I'm not talking about serious stuff like I am on these TV shows. I like to, you know, mess around and play different characters.
Well, hopefully there's a casting director or an agent watching who thinks, oh, that might be quite interesting. So you'd be up for that, would you?
I'd be well up for it, yeah.
Very good. In the meantime, I just wanted to congratulate you because you're not just talking about it. I mean, this is serious action. You are now an ambassador for the mental health charity SANE, and so you will be an inspiration to people, especially when they read the book. And it's lovely to have you here.
Yeah. Thank you very much.
Well done, you.
Thank you.
Thank you.